So today we're going to talk about part two of something that's significantly more important than LDL cholesterol. We'll get into the content for today. Part two of triglyceride over HDL ratio. Last week we talked about triglyceride over HDL ratio. What is it? Why is it important? And today we're going to talk about why it's important, the optimal ratio, ethnicity. You know, you'll hear when people start wading into the triglyceride over HDL ratio, you'll start hearing them quote numbers about, well, for the Latinx community, for the African-American community, for the Caucasian community. I'll give you a spoiler on that one. I think that part is way overdone. There's clearly patterns that we see in these different communities, but we'll talk about why I think that's way overdone, again, a little bit later in the content section. Probably the most important part of this, though, is how to naturally lower triglyceride and raise HDL. If you listen to this channel, you've heard it once, you've heard it 1,000 times. You can't supplement your way out of a lifestyle problem. You can't procedurize, surgerize, stent, bypass your way out of a lifestyle issue. And you can't prescribe your way out of a lifestyle issue. In other words, how can you naturally impact this? And this is the same theme. The natural ways of improving your triglyceride over HDL ratio are the best. What are those? We'll talk about them and how they work. And can lowering carbs improve triglyceride, HDL, remnant cholesterol, and cardiovascular risk? Brief spoiler, the answer is obviously yes. And we'll talk about how. So the triglyceride or HDL ratio is important. It's an important predictor of cardiovascular disease risk and a marker of insulin resistance. That's why when people come to me and they don't have any of the OGTT type tests or insulin resistance tests, even with a test that they usually have, and that is that old cholesterol test, I can start getting some really important information. And again, it's not so much about LDL here. It's about level of insulin resistance. So simply put, the blood triglyceride level over your HDL as measured by a lab test. That's what this ratio is. Now you go back to some of the older studies, older as in a decade ago, the WISE study stands for Women's Ischemia Syndrome Evaluation, or WISE. 544 women were referred to cardiovascular disease evaluation. The triglyceride over HDL ratio ranged from 0.3 to 18.4. Individuals with lower triglyceride over HDL ratio had lower cardiovascular risk. And again, that was one of the studies that really started to bring this to attention. It was in the American Heart Journal. The typical triglyceride over HDL cut points that you saw then and that you see now, I think are way too high, but we'll talk about that a little bit later as well. The recommendations you'll see are less than 2 is ideal and above 4 is too high. I would clearly agree with above 4 is too high. In European measurements, they're talking about less than 0.87 is ideal, or 0.87 millimoles per liter corresponds to milligrams per deciliter in the US, and 1.7 millimoles per liter corresponds to 4 milligrams per deciliter in the US. I have, again, a little bit stricter recommendations for what is optimal. Let's talk a little bit about ethnicity. So this was in a study by Willie and Associates, the Northern Manhattan study, race and ethnic differences in the relationship between lipid profile components and risk of myocardial infarction. Again, the Northern Manhattan study. So the triglyceride over HDL ratio appears to vary by ethnicity. Hispanic Americans, 3.9. Non-Hispanic Black, 2.9. Non-Hispanic White, 3.3. So therefore, does ethnicity matter? Should we have a different cut point for different ethnicities? I don't recommend focusing on that. There are several reasons, such as the fact that ethnicities are often mixed and maybe even unknown. You know, I've got some friends that consider themselves a walking rainbow. They've got Hispanic, they've got African American, they've got Caucasian blood all in the same person. So what is that person's ethnicity? So that's one reason, but there are other reasons as well. The biggest reason is that triglyceride over HDL ratio is an indicator of the health of insulin and glucose metabolism. The lower, the better. We know this is the most important thing that's killing us and disabling us on a regular basis. So let's keep an eye on that ratio. This doesn't even mention that most of the cut points used in research as markers for prediabetes are too high. For example, ratios of 2 and 3 confer risk no matter what your ethnicity happens to be or what mixes of ethnicity you happen to have. If your triglyceride over HDL is 3, you really need to focus on getting it down. And your goal should be 1 or less. The goal should be as low as possible. I recommend that my patients target 1.5 or less, and actually 1 if you can get there. And I've got plenty of patients. Chuck, for example, who I mentioned earlier, Chuck Smith, he had that heart attack and let his Tesla drive him to the hospital. He had already lost 50 pounds before he had that heart attack. It was on the low-fat diet. And he checked his triglyceride over HDL, found that it was varying between 5 and 7. That same Chuck now has his triglyceride over HDL ratios routinely below 1. So how did he do that? And how can we do that reliably? First of all, lose weight. Second, eat fewer carbs. Carbs have a big impact here. 3, exercise. 4, get dietary and supplemental omega-3s. There are medications that improve the triglyceride over HDL ratio as well. Statins actually do. Sometimes they have not the greatest impact in some of these areas, but most of the time they'll have like a 10 to 20% improvement on triglyceride over HDL. They can lower triglycerides by as much as 50%, but usually reliably 10 to 20%. The major impact of statins on the triglyceride over HDL ratio is its impact on the triglycerides. Other medications that impact that triglyceride over HDL ratio, the fibrates, Lopid, Fibricor, Tricor, prescription strength niacin and niacin supplements, both can decrease triglycerides, but also increase HDL. Prescription strength omega-3s, icosapent ethyl. You've heard that recently. It's the fish oil on steroids, or Vascepa, Epinova, Lavazza. They're all prescription forms of omega-3s. And again, there's a heck of a lot of supplemental forms of omega-3s. And there's a lot of dietary forms of omega-3s. I get mine from eating salmon. Now, can lowering carbs improve the triglyceride over HDL ratio? And what about RC? And what is RC? Remnant cholesterol. Can lowering carbs improve triglyceride over HDL ratio, the remnant cholesterol, and cardiovascular risk? Well, these studies over on the side and that we list on this page would indicate so. And I think that there's a lot more out there than just these studies. The Abbasi Study is a human clinical trial using a crossover design. People ate high carbs, 60% of their calories. That was their version of high carbs. For 2 weeks, then low carbs, that 40% was their version of low carbs for 2 weeks, and they had a washout period of 2 weeks in between. The high carb diet doubled triglyceride levels, tripled remnant cholesterol, and lowered HDL by 15%. So as you can see, that was a big impact with just a moderate change in carbs. The Wang study, it was a randomized clinical trial in mice. The Volex study, a meta-analysis. You remember, a meta-analysis is where you're looking at multiple studies. It reviewed pre-2005 studies, which had already shown that low-carb diets decrease triglycerides and remnant cholesterol while increasing HDL. The Ebeling study, it's also a human subjects clinical trial. It was done at Harvard. Subjects on a low-carb diet had lower triglyceride and higher HDL. How else are you going to improve that triglyceride over HDL ratio? Researchers also showed that the low-carb diets were less likely to result in weight rebound due to improved energy expenditure and leptin. Now let's go back and think about why and how. Why is there triglyceride in the blood? The most common reason for elevated triglycerides is prediabetes. Triglycerides can also become elevated in several inherited diseases. But again, the vast majority of increased triglycerides that I see are due to prediabetes. How does that happen? So here we go to how. Chronically high insulin stimulates adipokines and hormone-sensitive lipase. Hormone-sensitive lipase. We'll talk about that, what that is, in just a second. We covered that some last week, and this is repetition because it's a little bit technical and because a lot of folks on my channel have an interest on this molecular level and how that works. So hormone-sensitive lipase, that tells the body to start breaking up fats into fatty acids. This results in release of too many fatty acids from the fat cells. These excess fatty acids take up space in high-density lipoproteins and low-density lipoproteins. An enzyme called CETP, cholesterol ester transfer protein, facilitates the exchange of cholesterol in large HDL and large LDL with triglyceride. So in other words, what happens is you shrink and decrease your HDL population. Triglyceride-enriched HDL and LDL in turn are metabolized by hepatic liver lipase, resulting in loss of that large HDL. And we covered this last week, how you look at a fractionation. This is a fractionation of the HDL and LDL components. And what you should have, this is the HDL component. It should look like a bell curve, normal bell curve. But you have this place over on the right-hand side where a major chunk was taken out. That's because of this last process where VLDLs have a lot of triglycerides in them. They transfer that CETP, cholesterol ester transferase, transfers that triglyceride into the large HDL in exchange for cholesterol. That large HDL then gets metabolized by the liver. So that's why you get that big chunk of HDL taken out. So again, with these high carb diets, we get increased triglycerides and, as you see, decreased HDL. Continue to get great feedback regarding the webinars. And here's why. You know, on the internet, when you hear a webinar, you expect for somebody to try to sell you something. We're not doing that. We're trying to tell you something. People are coming in with their labs from Quest, inflammation panel, OGTT, insulin survey response, and then they're finding out, do I have inflammation? Do I have insulin resistance? And where does that fit in terms of other folks? We're getting ready to start one for CIMT as well. So again, people are really excited about finding out their own status. Looking forward to seeing you there. Thanks.